Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So I'm a Necron Cryptek, so what? Part number 10. 1161 years since Ishka's first awakening. Be Ishka empowered. The conflicts aboard the first fortress has been quelled, and after a weeks of continued assaults, all organisms aboard the fortress have been terminated. I have received comprehensive R, after action reports, and extensive glyph captures of the engagement. A Gakut was successful in terminating the remaining Ildari forces. The Solitor was critically wounded and placed within a stasis chamber. The constant stream of ceaseless droids, the arrival Phileas and one royal warden with a coterie of tombblades helped dispatch the final remnants of the forces. My attention had been transfixed upon the various hololithic displays showing the engagement in crisp detail. Phileas' arrival seemed to be the final nail in the coffin against the pesky mortals. Flicking through her encounter with the Wraithblade Black Line was amusing. Starlight from the rods of the Covenant shredded through the constructs. Heated blades with the power of contained dying stars flensed mortified Guardian defenders. Witnessing the expert blade work of Phileas threading between the limbs of the ancient warriors was something that stirred a level of intoxicating joy. I watched transfixed, watching her bisect a fleeing Guardian defender, replaying the scene with an almost perverse satisfaction. But I could not continue simply enjoying the opening scene of her arrival. I had the Farseer's engagement to observe. Her unfettered usage of the malign Neverseize tides was sickening. Smiting my warriors, hindering my loyal subject with maladies meant to doom him. And then witnessing the decaying powers she wielded with her rotted hand. She had replaced her own arm with the foul thing. Her right sleeve was torn free of her garb, olive-colored skin and spindly thin limb. It spoke of her lack of any exercise. But halfway up the length of her forearm was the rotted limb. The Hand of Darkness. Extending the crooked hand to eye level of my warriors, I saw malign fumes spread out, washing my warriors in the toxic fumes. A score of Necron warriors tried to fire upon her, but their weapons sputtered. Their knees buckled. Some tried striding forward, but only reached a few paces. Their joints hardened. Oxidized rust overcame them. The light of their eyes flickered. Limbs came apart. Bodies collapsed. Those closest to the Farseer fell away. When they collapsed to the floor, they simply broke apart in clouds of dust. She took many warriors, immortals, and even spindle drones with her. An uncounted number of the droids were lost to her constant use of the horrid limb. For a brief period, it seemed as though she had a chance to survive. She had hid herself often enough behind the great Wraithlord constructs. But when the two great Wraithlords came under fire by the Seraptech Construct's singularity generators, hope waned for her people. And she was able to watch in horror at what a Gakut had done to the Solitaire. The psychic shriek that emanated from her was only comparable to the deafening cry of that of the howling banshees of her future descendants. It was around this time that Phileas and her cohort had dispatched the last of her Wraithblade entourage. The Farseer's death was not one that spoke of glory. Only a pathetic defiance. She was truly the last left upon the battlefield. Whatever goal she had planned, failed. Her army was destroyed. Her telekine defenses failed her, punched through by unceasing plasma, gorse, and Tesla bombardment. She desperately lashed out at dozens of ranks of warriors, even managing to kill some in her frenzied panic. But she was a caged animal. Nowhere to run. Forces everywhere. And so eventually, after her body had been sufficiently mangled by beams from the Praetorian's weapons, she fell to the floor. Knelt down, seemingly in prayer. Phileas was the one to stride up to her, placing her relic war scythe before the neck of the Farseer. And ultimately beheading the sorceress Zeno. I had the body of the Farseer reclaimed along with the Hand of Darkness. Phileas had cause to argue with me, but it would seem she knew the consequences of defying me in my current state. The Solitaire, the Farseer and the Hand were transported to the depths of the fortress into one of its myriad vaults. Through my own neural pathways, I tried uncovering some hidden fragments of my ruined psyche. With some effort, I indeed was able to unlock some fragmented knowledge. burning into the Blackstone ancient dimensional wards known only by the secretive remaining members of the Technomond rites. I had the bodies tucked away, whilst the hand remained within my possession. I would not allow them to be in any proximity to such a relic. Trazian had informed me of his various acquisitions and of the heading of the Great Craft World. But that was not my goal. Let the Eldari take it for now. Clarity had returned to me. As a Necron, I had been blinded by far too many thoughts and plagued by mortal failures. We had been right at the cusp of something great. A detail I had overlooked. We were in the Gethsemane subsector. The greatest prize of all lies here in the war-torn fringe of the galaxy. All I would need to do is remain conscious after disconnecting from the fortress and I would remain intact. I ordered a small fleet for myself, and ordered only the trusted resurrected Agaklet and the cryptic Nehebkor to assist me in this venture I had planned. Removing myself without succumbing to power overload was a delicate process. An entire week of orchestrating power elsewhere without breaking this grand form. This form was far more beneficial but limited my reach. In time I would return to it once more. But for now I had to settle with being mortal. An idea that irked me to no end. When I severed my connection to the fortress's power grid, I was returned relatively in one piece. My memories of the time in such a form were difficult to read. I understood I did certain actions but was unaware of their higher purpose. To add to it, I find the edges of my essence totem links haven't entirely transmuted back into their respective state of matter. Rather, the fringes of the tiles have a composition of that of the Cetan necrodermis. Some of the Cetan state bled over into my apparel, it would seem. A matter for another time. For I had one course that I had set myself up for. For the planet of Ornsworld. The home of the Eye of Night. Phileas and Orokin protested this. And I simply informed them I had divined a means of jump-starting our two suboptimal fortresses. We had only half roused them. They were hardly fit for any level of combat at the time. And to have five fortresses against a single craft world would make it all the easier to claim the fortress. They relented. And for 2 months we scoured the world in search of the relic. 2 months we subjected every mile of the planet to uncounted scans in search of the relic. 2 months of thousands of scarabs moving between the native flora looking for the relic. And after hundreds of man hours we found the eye, set upon a statue of a humanoid being. Or rather an Eldari one at that. The eye had been procured at the site of hallowed Eldari grounds. Trazin was made to excavate the entire site. An entire cubic mile claimed. This warranted further study and Trazin was the one to do so for me. Orokin called me mad for doing so. A waste of time, he said. I ended any interstitial messaging with him and returned to the two fortresses not yet fully operational. Arriving at the first not yet fully operational fortress, my mind was bristled with streams of static data from the fortress. Its vast intelligence sensing the artifact. The sense of acknowledgement. The eye itself erected with some level of movement. Reconstructing itself, individual components connecting, repositioning and rotating. My own cortical feed pinged off a form of radiation emanating from the trinket. I would not bring this artifact to the command spire, taking it to the fortress's mind. I entered a chamber several levels below the command spire. Far deeper than I'd adventure in previous visits. Impassable walls broke away to reveal the choir chamber. Plunging head forward, I strode for the fortress's inner workings. Her song clearer to me than ever before. I could make out. Not words but merely the impression of them. The fortress was cautioning me on the blood I would spill, the upheaval this action would have, the ripples this would cause within the realm of souls. For a moment this stilled me. I had been a few short meters from a great slab wall, an impression in the wall seemingly ready for the Eye of Night to be placed within. I considered the idea for some time. I had already been responsible for the death of thousands of Eldari, even if not directly. Their blood had already drenched my hands. For what reason did the fortress have to try and stroke out my morality? I was already on this heading. The Eldari could not be given a chance to win, could they? The fortress tried to get me to consider the possibility of ceasefire. No, not a ceasefire. The idea was more akin to an armistice. Leaving one another to their own devices. Blurred images of the intact Eldari ships informed me I could open communications with the craft world and its fleet. We had more than sufficiently captured prisoners of war. Or more specifically, possible gallery pieces for Trazim. Would that be enough to ask them to flee the fortress and leave us be? At our current state, we were more than capable of destroying the entire craft world and any forces they had. I had considered the fortress ideas before pressing the Eye of Night into the impression where the eye fit. Placing it within the impression, the room went momentarily dark. The eye seemingly drained all ambient light from the chamber. Only a faint illumination came from the relic. Sparks of electricity jumped across the relic, bouncing onto previously unseen patterns on the slab. Light flooded the chamber in an instant as the room began to emanate with overwhelming energy. The fortress cognition overwhelmed my own as the psychic technologically thrummed to life. Readouts of thousands of chambers flooded my mind. Thousands of hidden chambers I had missed were there. Access to the psychic emanations. A deeper understanding of Blackstone. Flickering images of the galaxy as a completed map washed over my eyes. Visions of the first salvos of the fortress during the Great War. The fortress was alive. We sailed for months with the fully awakened fortresses. Their minds were bridged together across the expanse of space. Five flying star forts in perfect unison on a heading for Aura subsector. Flying ahead commanding my own, I made careful adjustments to the flight paths of each fortress. Communication across all of the fortresses was free rein. I discussed the possibility of communication with the Yieldery with the other high-ranking officials. Nahabgor, Orokin, and Phileas seemed against this. They proactively called for the Yieldery's destruction. Trazin was the only one who vouched for me, strangely enough. I clarified my stance and the reasons. There is no possibility we will reach the fortress before them. I reasoned. We have seen them jury-rig the warp cannons before, and you've seen the extensive damage that has caused to our fleet and our own fortress. As if on cue, the fortress projected images of our latest void combat. The extensive damage between Trazin's fortress and the others. Having had to disable one warp cannon. And lastly, the extensive ruin we left an entire sector in. Orokin spoke up. You suggest we simply let the Yieldery turn to tail with the fortress. I huffed. We call for an armistice. We return some of the prisoners we have captured. I have a selection of several units, an entire arsenal, and multiple captured ships. We can exchange those for the fortress, and we can call off conflicts for a number of centuries or millennia. And think of the precedent that would provide. From what I've gathered, this in roughly 10 million years from now, we will see the first instance of mutual joining of forces of Yieldery and Necron kind. I can see it clearly as the day I had divined it. The Ferrak-Hazep-Ket would come to a mutual understanding. A temporary truce with the Yieldery against a mutual foe. And then, I let myself go quiet for a moment. Well, an earlier instance, one between the highest of our kind, would seek alliances with a primitive race that shall dominate much of our galaxy. I pictured the Silent King Quater vividly and his interaction with the Blood Angels. We eventually did reach the Aura subsector. Already we could see Yieldery fleets rushing past us. Far less suicidal than their previous counterparts. They all were heading more or less where we expected. When we finally came into sight of the craft world, I immediately gasped. Putting it to scale, it was equivalent to the size of a small planet, the size of the planet Mercury. Nearly 5,000 kilometers long, bearing dozens of imposing weaponry. Pulsar lances, massive scale D weapons, and at least 4 infinity cannons I could count. That didn't even mention the dozen of fleet elements. Several battle cruisers. Roughly 50 ships, not mentioning light cruisers, escorts, and the uncounted attack craft. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store, as well as desktop, for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match. 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEARDIA for 10% off, and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app, and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. I had the fortress try to connect with the strange systems of one of the captured ships. It took a few minutes before we were calling the Eldery Craft World. After some time arriving onto my screen, we were met by a helmed Farseer looking character and a whole host of warlocks surrounding them. Their color scheme reminded me of my mirror, if a bit darker. The Farseer spoke, a voice that crackled with the same strange psychic crackle I heard hundreds of times now. "What reason would you have to speak with us?" They sounded more disgusted than anything. I spoke up before Phileas could try and end the call. "I am simply a concerned denizen of the galaxy, you see, noble craftworlder. Surely you've seen the state of the realm of souls?" That got a head tilt from them. I continued. "With no level of annoyance, we have had to repel your forces for the last 27 years now, no? These unnecessary deaths have really ravaged a number of subsectors, is it not? And for what? A chance that you may attain. MHMH. I let out a little chortle. The elusive talisman of our eye was cut off there. "What point does your droning have, you insidious skeleton?" The Farseer barked. I was pleasantly surprised by the insult. "The point, my knife and companion, is that I am offering you an armistice. We can go our separate ways without further bloodshed. You will receive the citizens of yours we've captured, those soul stones of your less physically capable, the ships, the military assets. In exchange, you leave the fortress immediately. Afterwards, we will leave one another alone." The Farseer let out a barely perceivable huff. "You expect us to accept this farce?" they answered. "You have been our immortal enemy for ages untold. There has never been precedent for us to trust any of your kind. Sooner I would work the feral orcs than I would deal with the Necker." I slammed my fist down with unprecedented strength. The resounding crack halted the Eldery's quip. "My apologies," I started. "Perhaps I didn't make myself clear enough. You've seen reports of the power of the fortress, have you not?" I asked. I answered for them before a single syllable escaped their mouth. "Of course you have. Your piteous forces have kept you well informed of much, haven't they? One, to burn an atmosphere. Two, to kill a planet, as you've no doubt seen from whatever forces eluded us from capturing two of these fortresses. Do you know what happens when three fortresses can do, Farseer?" They remained silent for a moment. "What can they do, Necron?" they asked with disdain. I let out some laughter that seemed to unsettle Phileas and all those watching my actions. "I can show you, dear Farseer." Three fortresses broke off from the formation. The ships moved back to the east. Already the Eldery were making defensive formations and the massive cannons were aiming upon us. "Still your quaking boots, knife ears, this is a demonstration," I barked over the vidlink. This didn't ease them one bit. They headed to the outer edge of space. To the nearest star. A red dwarf. It burned a bright crimson with notes of roaring orange between. And then the cannons started up, warp energies coalescing. "I wish to show you something, Elder. I wish for you to know that your people's lives are in your hands. From this point we can continue on our ways, without bloodshed." I turned to the display of the fortresses. "Or we can resume our million years feud, one that I would win against you." The fortresses fired in unison. A trio of bright violet-white beams roared out across the reach of space. I could see some elements of the fleet of Eldery break and try and flee. The trio of beams hammered into a fine point. Momentarily the intersected beams wavered. Like roaring tides fighting back against one another, wrestling dominance from one another. And then the beams settled in one glorious union. The intersecting mass fired downwards over the star it orbited. "Star gods!" I heard Orokin exclaim in shock. "No." Trazian was enraptured by the display. I heard many more gasps and surprised expletives from the crowd. The beams struck down at the sun. A cascade of roiling solar flares toiled on the sun's bright surface. For a moment it seemed as though the star was expanding. The great star continued to expand outwards, flares lashing out violently before the trio disembarked. It was already too late. It only grew brighter, hotter, larger. It would expand out in a combustion of gases and kaleidoscopic wonder. ancient things far older than he himself had been rendered to rapidly expanding in all directions. An outer ring of orbiting satellite stars were consumed, reduced to miles of ash and waste blown across the void. There was unease in the Farseer's council. They spoke with some resolve, but I could tell they were still concerned. And you think we would just hand over such a weapon to you? It was a genuine question. I nodded once. Yes, I honestly do. I said somberly. The Eldari watched us in quiet compilation. They were communicating with one another. I could already notice movements in their fleet. The trio of fortresses would be back into position soon enough. To think, what the Elder had just witnessed. An entire eon's old star destroyed with only a short period of firing. In the end they accepted our deal. This was not an easily accepted decision amongst the fleet. In fact, an entire third of their army would try their hands at bringing war to us. The rest of the fleet backed off, rebuking their brothers who were flying into annihilation. Wholly over 100 ships, 3 void stalkers and a mass of light cruisers, escorts, and attack craft soared towards us. When they reached the firing range they took their shots, a veritable sea of light sailing right at us. I could hear the Farseer's panic as he was fighting amongst his council, some condemning him for cowardice, some calling him King Killer and so much more. He hurled insults and chicanery at his brethren, condemning them as bloodthirsty mongrels of Cain. I called the fleet of fortresses to mobilize upon the Eldari who had taken shots at us. We engaged in brutal void combat. Dozens of ships popped in violent detonation as streams of warp fire consumed them. Their weapons batteries were eating at our unified shields, and it would be seconds before it went down. Occasionally two warp cannon salvos met, popping entire ranks of the formation. And then they tore into our shield. A puff of light broke out as their attack craft made way to harm us. Their slower vessels were taking pot shots at us. Damage readouts were slowly filtering in, they had yet to take aim at our warp cannons. I counted that as a blessing and ordered Trazin to show them what is null beam cannon. It tore at the Eldite cruisers, the Wraithbone scattering away all psychic potential burned off in the emerald colored beam. I could only guess at what happened to their souls as they were washed in the devastating destruction. We advanced tired of the combatants' persistence. Unleashing a trio of beams and happily destroying many. The remaining felt the unrestrained damage of the unstable warp fire beam from our more damaged fortress. It left the void of space burning with warp fire, like an isolated little warp tear. The fire spread across those who had formed up too close. Seeing this devastation, some tens of ships disengaged. Finally, only a group of 10 ships surrounding the void stalker remained. It wasn't stopping and was heading straight for my fortress. They planned to ram my fortress in their dying breath. I resumed the call to the Farseer, who had been trying to get a handle on his people. I will not blame you for your subordinates' actions, no. So long as you overlook what I'm about to do next. I asked. The Farseer nodded. It pained him to do so, it seemed. I will concede this fight to you, Necron. I could not be so foolish as to allow your powers befall my people. I ended the connection and connected my consciousness to the fortress. I spoke with the fortress, as much as one could speak with a being incapable of direct communication. You have been harmed, my fortress. Invaders come to wreak havoc on your beautiful form. I ask you let them in, I ask. I waited for a moment. Recalling some several passages from the Ascension book. I hesitated before speaking. I wish for you to consume and learn, my dear fortress. Consume that void stalker, my fortress. The void stalker didn't crash into a blaze of glory that broke the shell of the fortress. There was no resounding explosion. There wasn't any indication of the existence of the void stalkers afterwards. It had simply been absorbed into the fortress, to be absorbed into the Noctolith. The breakaway force had been routed and we made heading for the Farseer's craft world. We were amid the wreckages of warp fire, broken and half disintegrated ships. I began my talks with the Farseer that had no choice but to surrender the fortress to us. We returned his prisoners' ships, and several other assets we had acquired. Not everything of course, but more than enough to keep him placated. As promised, he left us to our work. His forces fleeing en masse. And finally we could take hold of the last star fort. After several centuries we had claimed six fortresses, both the Hand of Darkness and Eye of Night. We had won the Gothic War. And I had become this galaxy's despoiler. We began a 50-year voyage back to the Vuklas Dynasty's territories. There was no end to the boredom. I was mentally exhausted from any major project and needed time to let my mind rest. I oversaw several last-minute requests. I had to make some paints for some reason, and delegated several projects. Lastly, I simply directed Orokin to the direction he would need to go to further his studies. He would be disembarking in a few years to the ominous crown world of Hashta. Many centuries of study would occupy his time, and he was more than aware of my threat of trying to steal any relics. I had given him enough cause to fear me. With that, informed my fleet commanders of my absence for the remaining 4 decades of the voyage. I left them with several feature-length films, movie series, animated series. Enough to occupy their time. I sequestered myself away in my dimensional warded room, a vaulted room that none but myself could access for the time. And I entered a willing stasis, letting my mind fill with nothing but dead static. Dreaming. Be Ferak Savarek of the Vuklat Dynasty. For the last 2 centuries the reigning nobility of the Hemanth Dynasty been in constant discussions of matters of settling rights. I have allowed them some craft to move across our realm. We had several worlds under our control, none inhabited beyond Canoptech constructs. I have yet been able to discover a means to access the Cryptek's blasted room. The workshop of the Technomorites that once inhabited the room had spent several centuries warding their facilities with dimensional wards and a myriad of other defenses. I had no means of accessing it even if I had one of the Saratech constructs try and attack it, it was simply too secure. What wasn't defended was the Cryptek's reconstructed primitive home. I ventured to this chamber he had modified. A great part of the chamber had been converted into what many of the Deathmarks and Immortals called a movie theater. Browsing their mnemonics, I was to observe the various clips of movies on a primitive biped documentary. These were humans. He had spoken much of them when he was recounting his visions. A primitive race which he had an intensive amount of knowledge of their history and advancements. The Bronze Age, the Industrial Revolution, the Modern Era, the Golden Age, the Age of Strife, Long Night and the Great Crusade. It was almost perverse how much he spoke of them. Much more perverse was how he made one of their abominable homes in my tomb. I explored this simple home. A 2-story home, a few small rooms, a living space dedicated to observing a monitor, a kitchen, a simple table. Every single detail had been carefully rendered, even the smallest grooves in the floorboards, the wrinkles in the furniture, the strange texture of the walls and ceiling. Ishka had many eccentricities before he had awoken, but this was a realm of eccentricity that bordered the mind-warpingly maddening. Every cabinet, every cupboard, every single inch of this damned house was filled with another infuriating detail. Eventually making my way to the bedrooms, I took note of several books. Now that was most curious. Books made with black stone scripts and thin metallic sheets, alien writing I couldn't recognize. It held texts, and after several hours of running them through my translation algorithms I could understand these literary pieces. These texts spoke of whimsical adventures. Games of pen and paper. Fictitious babble that didn't concern my attention. All the same I read each from cover to cover. Call of Cthulhu 1st through 7th edition, Cyberpunk 1st to 2nd, Degensis, Dungeon World, Dungeon and Dragons 1st through 5th edition, Fate, Godbound, GURPS, Kill 6 Billion Demons, Lancer, Legend of the Five Rings, Pathfinder 1st through 2nd edition, Star Wars Role Playing, Starfinder, Vampire the Requiem, Vampire the Masquerade. Each of them had dozens of modules and adventurers. I now understood some of the miniatures and small containers of dice. These were all fictitious texts. Some of them I took for myself, only those concerning technological advancements. The rest I burned. I had several Canoptech constructs and his own Scorpioid constructs reduce the house to nothing. No more of that, Ishika. These perversions will not be allowed to stand. Pray you return with something of note. I tilted my head to the side as I watched them being dismantled along with the theater. Perhaps Phileas will kill you. I voiced to no one in particular. Be high transmogrifier Ishskar of the Votek dynasty. No, not transmogrifier, that wasn't quite right. I am a son. I am a brother. I am an Akrontid. I am a Technomandrite. I am one of a long line of hidden artificers, scholars, scientists, and weaponsmiths. For our gifts we were prosecuted, murdered, hunted like beasts. Our numbers were culled, thinned to fledgling forces across a million worlds. Never again to serve again in the open. My family was spared, to a world of concubines and merchants. We gritted our teeth, and worked as artisans, forced to hide our greater labors. They used up our weaponry and forced the few remaining of our kind to maintain them. And the Technomandrites were forgotten in the war the Silent Kings drove us into. A failure of a war. We were shamed and disgraced for our talents and these hypocrites began to soil our history. An echo of our people existed in the Cryptek temples. Astromancers, Chronomancers, Diviners, Geomancers, Plasmancers. My ancestors took this as a cover. And the concubines and merchants made use of our talents to maintain their power. What fools they were. It's all jumbled within my mind, fragments of my personality. My memories. My dreams. My aspiration. Even now I can hardly recall much beyond my hatred. My hatred for the Ferak Savarek. No, not Ferak. That wretched woman was but a concubine. She was never destined for the throne. I can recall her form. A lithe thing, plaid flesh, scared by tumor scars and lesions. Her voice was like ice on my skin. She had called for my services often, just as the Feren did. The wisdom of my people was often sought and so we were ingrained within the nobility. Only those that knew us as Technomandrites and not as the Cryptex we masqueraded as. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also we have started selling 5th edition adventures with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you go ahead and check the link below but let's get back to the video. I felt a heat roaring over my wrists. Muscles aching, red hot metal being folded over and over. Beads of sweat trailing down my cheeks, heated breaths escaping my mouth with labored breaths. Work I enjoyed, a responsibility that I was honored to do. My trembling hands lifted a pair of massive razor sharp blade, no that wasn't quite right. An expression of devotion, a pure representation of love. I labored away on these ceremonial blades, hyperface weapons inscribed with an oath of devotion. One dedicated to the Feren and the other dedicated to his bride-to-be. Each of them had commissioned me to make a pair of blades, both having an expensive set of requirements and complex designs tracing the weapon. I admired their love for one another. Not just because I was commissioned to work on such a piece. But because I had excelled in every way to make such weapons. Weeks had I spent ensuring every atom of the twin blades had been perfected. I had created my magnum opus. Both an art piece of inexhaustible beauty and an equally finely forged instrument of war. My ancestors would have been proud. I killed the forge. Silencing the thrumming hums of the great machinery. I would present these weapons to the newlyweds. Fragments of the days that followed flicked through my mind. My magnum opus tarnished. The Feren dead. A Ferak is crowned. Her unborn children would never know their father. My body felt red hot. Anger like no other burned through me. No other saw this for what it was. The damn concubine had murdered the Feren with my weapon. She had slain her partner, her husband, the one she had devoted over a decade of her life to. And she had done it with her oath blade. My finest creation. And I could do nothing. The Technomandrites could do nothing. Suddenly I am brought back to reality. I am a Necron. And all that I have remembered should not have reached me. That information should have been removed with surgical precision. A section of my neural matrices has been severed from my being. These memories should not be available to me without it. but all the same I have fragmented access to them. Prolonged existence in the Seitan form has altered me on a metaphysical and neurological way. Or perhaps it is also the constant mingling with the fortress vast intellect. Yes. This is why I am changing. And then there is the other being. The human thing that possesses my shell of a body. I have bore witness to their biological life dozens of times. These memories give me insight to the strange nature of this being. The information hundreds of tomes, audio clips, tactical simulations, crude tabletop strategizing. They were beholden to the secrets of the galaxy, the nature of primordial beings, the flow of time for this reality. And they were making use of it, not efficiently but using it for the benefit of the Necron all the same. They had claimed 6 great weapons, and retained the secrets of each purpose from all. He has been unaware of my awakening. Be Executioner Phileas of the Treok Praetorian. We have campaigned for nearly 28 years, and spent multiple centuries retrieving each of these Blackstone fortresses. This has been a costly endeavor for all but Trezin. We had not anticipated the Eldari to engage us in any capacity. Yet infuriating, they nearly cost us a great asset. I don't expect them to take this defeat lying down. In time they will amass a force to take us on. And we would be ready then. I can sense the changes in Cryptek. He has become less spineless than before. In the last centuries he has knocked for my permission and choices above his station. Instead he simply expects my tolerance. I will admit I have been far more lax than I should be, but there is something about this Cryptek. The knowledge he so casually wields borders on madness. Not Orokin, greatest of our diviners, could have predicted these results. Nor had the Celestial Orrery come to predict the nature and sheer scale of this endeavor. I had consulted both before this venture had begun. This would not be a weapon that I could take from him. As it stands, controlling the fortress was a permission that he allowed. He still had greater aims, there were more schemes to be hatched. When we began making our way back to his dynastic tomb world, he had not spoken to me. Avoiding me entirely. He gave a simple message to all within our command structure. He would sequester himself away for the next 4 decades. He would not be bothered. None could protest as he had hidden himself away before anyone could oppose. After 5 fruitless weeks of searching his last known location, he had simply gone. But he had left something for us to inspect. Some of these movies he had shown his awakened warriors. With little in the ways of duties I opted to watch. Rank upon rank of immortals, warriors Canoptech servants, and thousands upon thousands of the constructs. Simple-minded things, but all the same they were useful things. Losses sustained by B1 droids were of such little consequence it actually yielded some level of advantage. When their ranks died en masse, they could be used for cover. I moved past all of them and headed to the frontmost rows, taking my seat amongst Trezin, Overlord. I acknowledged him with a nod as I took my seat. He returned the nod, Executioner, and replied with a nod. I continued our conversations. These movies, having researched the mnemonics some centuries ago and saw brief vid captures of biologicals, humans I believe they were called. Trezin spoke once more. I believe his lord called many of these films theatrical performances. He continued. I must admit I have been quite curious to witness them. Of course he would. Trezin was always hoarding information. This would be no different. We watched several of these films in succession. Though the first set of series-based movies was the Mummy Trilogy. Agakat, Trezin, and I all noted an unusually familiar naming convention. Along with aesthetics. Trezin voiced through interstitial messages the striking similarities the ancient mortals' cultural attire shared with the Necrontid. The concubine's attire was entirely unsightly. All the same, these mortals seemed to be emulating our long-forgotten people's culture. There was an unsettling aspect in that. Over the course of these movies I had learned more than enough about these biological creatures. A diverse collective of innumerable subcultures, the prosperous could live to a century. They were free of the radiation-blasted suns, and from what most of these films suggested was that they were tethered to a single planet. Earth, these theatrical performances were unlike any performances our kind have ever experienced. greater reverence and attention to detail of the wars they fought in, along with the thinly veiled patriotic propaganda many of these films propagated. It was only natural for these mortals to do so. I had ordered Trazim to dissect these films. I would know what was fact and what was fiction. If the capabilities of these humans was truly at levels comparable to us, then I would have to track this soul system and destroy this fledgling race. Days continued on before we begin to watch the extensive series known as the Star Wars. A series I was led to believe was composed of 9 movies, but I was sorely mistaken. A whimsical series involving dozens of strange Xenos races and these humans wielding a power that at first I believed to be Emperor forces. But it was not so. These biologicals wielded a fictitious source of power known as the Force. I was disgusted by this, but in time I grew intrigued. I found the source of the Scarab Chari's innovations. Many of these constructs were impractical, but a select few could be used in the Immortal Empire. After well over 100 animated episodes, several movies, and branching but related films, I had noted an extensive number of constructs, vehicles, weapons designs I wished to have replicated. There was much to ponder upon. Need to wake up. Feel extremely cold actually, and everything feels stiff. When I finally take a peek around, I find that I'm not alone. 2 alabaster and midnight black colored tripod limbed constructs stand to either side of me, their backs to me. They haven't noticed me yet. It takes me a second to identify what the hell they are. The massive talon limbs, the spindly limbs. They are guardian drones, one of the stronger constructs of the fortresses. Immediately I let out an audible sigh. We're a few short hours away from the tomb world. I've managed to sleep through the 40 years of travel. There weren't any thoughts, any sense of time, or any enjoyment of sleep. Just a ceasing in any motor, mental, or interstitial function. I held onto the edges of the sarcophagus and heaved myself free. I could hear the click and pop of wires being tugged free from the various sockets in my back. Come, I've rested long enough. I headed for one of the smooth black walls. Momentarily I glanced back at the chamber. I felt the expectant waiting of the fortress. It knew I wanted to ask it questions before I allowed myself out of the room. Can you see me? See my soul? I clarified. A whispered hush cut through all thoughts. Its chilled voice sending pangs of pain through my head. Yes. The fortress rumbled into my consciousness. Wonderful. I murmured. The wall broke in segmented blocks, revealing a tunnel exit. I left my sanctum, the pathway fading back with the silent merging of the walls. There had been no evidence the chamber had ever existed. I immediately had myself translated to the other side of the fortress into the command spire. The very second I arrived, I received a ping. Phileas was trying to contact me. I pinched my temples and opened the line. Her tone told me she was annoyed, which I suppose it would be when I avoided her for 40 years before she could object. Cryptek, where have you been? I have been trying to speak with you for more than 3 decades. She hissed. I inhaled sharply and gave a quick answer. I was indisposed. Now what is it that you wanted to ask me? She scoffed but continued on. You are needed on the bridge. Your Ferak demands your audience. I must have voiced my displeasure across the line as she spoke more harshly soon after. Now Cryptek, afterwards you and I will have a long discussion. I cut the line and headed up for the command bridge. Everyone that mattered was on the bridge. It seems Her Eminence Ferak Savarek is on the screen. Oh, it looks like every time I think about her it forces me to put words of grandeur before I think of her name. I reflexively prostrate myself before her. I swear I hear a small hello over the line. My Ferak, how may I say? With thinly veiled disgust. It seems you've brought back a great boon to my dynasty. She boldly announced. I felt pangs of anger bubble up. Something like that, yes. But before you come to this, I believe there was something promised to me upon the retrieval of just one of the fortresses. All eyes fell on me. I could hear curses, surprise gasps, and a faint chuckle from the assembled Necron on the bridge. This was a breach of all rules of etiquette. I was basically demanding what was owed to me, which in polite society according to the Necrons, is never done. You don't demand something from a Ferak, But now I've made it abundantly clear there was something that Ferak had that I wanted. The rest of my brain. My body was hoisted into the air and slammed with a resounding clang of metal on stone. Phileas was pinning me down on the ground. I knew you lacked decorum, Cryptek, but this is even beyond you. What achievement makes you think you can look down upon your Ferak? Her voice was a barely contained hiss against my ear. At that moment, tremors rumbled through the fortress. The cool blue of the inner chamber suddenly shifted to a deep red. Dozens of warnings flashed across my ocular lens. What's happening? I heard Savarek bark over the link. I was undamaged by Phileas thanks to the sempiternal weave that was bonded over and between my atoms. I spoke softly over the sudden commotion. Phileas, release me. Please. I added quietly. She lifted me up so I could at least look at the face of the Ferak. Slowly she removed her Herculean grip from neck. She shot me a death glare, her death mask unflinching. She didn't need to say anything to let me know I needed to speak carefully. The Ferak broke the silence. I don't need to tell you what any further brazen insubordination or disrespect will yield for your existence. She lifted something into view, a hyperface blade of exceptional make. I felt something inside me stir. Yes, my Ferak. I bowed my head. You will be given your little prize, Cryptek, but disturb me no more on the matter. She let out a slight huff. It sounded like annoyance to even be talking to me. Follow the orbit of the gas giant. Those fortresses combined would disturb the gravitational rotation of any tomb world within my domain. A new flight path was given to my Voidmancer. The Ferak terminated the line. Phileas finally let me stand upright. You continue to test my patience, Cryptek. This isn't amusing. She hisses. I will try not to in the future, my executioner, but I had reason for this lack of decorum. Elaborate, Ishska, before I grow tired of your snake's game of schemes. She ordered. I cleared my throat unnecessarily. It gives you reason to be there, reason to witness what dealings the Ferak engages in. She was quiet after that. I had just ensured the security of my brain. The Ferak would have no chance to destroy my brain with Phileas watching her closely now. And if she reveals to Phileas that I'm a Technomandrite, she'll go down with me. Mutually assured destruction. We arrived at the gas giant. Already we got a ping of several fleet vessels heading our way. The Voidmancer noted the Ferak's tomb ship heading our way. She was to dock down on my first fortress. I would await her on the docking bay, a full honor guard, and Phileas would accompany to meet the Ferak. I noted several constructs were in attendance to greet her as well. I noted several unusual scarabs amongst the tide of scarab swarms. I don't remember bringing them. I gave them a quick scree. And my stomach sank. Cortical subjugator scarabs. I ordered them to disperse. Hide to leave the dock. I couldn't risk Phileas or really anyone discovering them. They had been created by me at some point. I had no memory of making something like that. I had no idea I had something like that in my arsenal. My nerves eventually calmed as the tomb ship slowly flew into the docking bay. It hardly took up any space within the fortress. It took a few minutes before she disembarked, accompanied by a full Hanorgut that easily dwarfed our own forces. This blatant display of power felt more petty than intimidated. We toured the fortress for weeks. I had the fortress rebuild certain facilities and hide the vaults being encountered. She observed many of the advancements I had made, and the countless masses of cheaply produced units. She was inquisitive and often asked for clarification on the functions of the fortress, or if its technology could be blended with our own. Her presence along with Phileas was suffocating. For now I would try and follow dynastic etiquette. After having shown her the ship's translation center, she finally gave the order I was dreading. Take me to the command center. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.